Welcome to all of those who are here, as well as all those who are watching us online. And just remember, when I talk about a prophet, I am not talking about a fortune teller, a person who just predicts things. I'm talking about a foreteller, one who speaks of the way the world ought to be. And so what I'd like to do to begin this sermon this morning, to kind of warm us up a little bit, is I'd like to read a selection of passages from the Hebrew prophets. And after each one, I'm going to kind of invite us to pause and ask ourselves if we find that passage appealing. Does that sound good to everybody? All right. So here we go. First one. Let justice roll down like waters and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream. I have to say that I actually wrote that before James Comey tweeted it on Friday. That's the prophet Amos. Let justice roll down like waters and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream. I find that passage appealing, right? How about this one? What does the Lord require of thee but to do justice, love mercy, and to walk humbly with thy God? That's Micah. Or a couple from Isaiah. They shall beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. Also Isaiah. Everyone who thirsts, come to the waters, and you that have no money, come, buy and eat. Come, buy wine and milk without money and without price. Why do you spend your money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which does not satisfy? To tell you, I could keep going. I could fill the rest of this hour with beautiful quotes from the Hebrew prophets, but I want to muddy things up a little bit. I want to give you a few other images to think about. You see, even though the prophet spoke of these beautiful, ever-flowing, justice like an ever-flowing stream, they were also trouble. The prophets, the Hebrew prophets, were to a person loud, disruptive, and offensive. They were scandalous. The prophets dressed in rags or often in hair shirts. They didn't bathe. They would cover themselves in dirt and ashes. It was often said that you could smell that the prophet was coming before you could see them. Their hair was wild and unkempt. They were offensive. They were disruptive. In Isaiah, the prophet Isaiah, in one verse, strips naked and parades through the streets criticizing Israel's leaders. And not to be outdone, Jeremiah tops even that. There is this passage in which Jeremiah, following God's instructions, is instructed by God, Jeremiah is instructed by God to take a soiled loincloth, and to take the soiled loincloth into the desert and hide it under a rock. Then Jeremiah is instructed several months later to return, retrieve the loincloth, to take it in to the kingdom, into the palace, to wave it, and to tell the rulers, this is a symbol of your leadership. You can read that in Jeremiah. So I can even, there are examples that are over and above this, but. So you want to know what's truly remarkable? What's truly remarkable, of the 39 books in the Hebrew Bible, 15 are the writings of the prophets. Isaiah and Jeremiah and Ezekiel and Jonah and Joel and Amos and Micah and Zechariah and Zephaniah and more. 40% of the books in the Hebrew Bible are books about the prophets. They are far and away, there are far and away more prophetic texts than there are any other kind of scriptural genre. There are more writings from the prophets than there are prayers and songs, more prophetic texts than wisdom writings. The writings of the prophets are longer than than even the five books of Moses. So let that sink in for a second. Isaiah the streaker and Jeremiah the dirty underwear waver and their fellow prophets play a larger role in the Bible than any other type of literature in either the Hebrew Bible or the New Testament. Isn't that something? Every prophetic text begins pretty much in the same fashion. Here's how Isaiah begins. The vision which Isaiah, son of Amos, had about Judah and Jerusalem during the reigns of Uzziah, Jotham, Ahaz, and Hezekiah, kings of Judah. Here's how Jeremiah begins. The word of the Lord came to Jeremiah in the 13th year of the reign of Josiah, son of Amon, king of Judah. These are political texts. And then the prophets let loose. They let them have it. The kings, the rulers, the priests, the judges, we hear about in graphic, unflinching detail the oppression and exploitation that exists under them. We hear about the suffering of the poor. We hear about the refusal to care for the orphan and the widow, the sick and the stranger. We hear about greed, about the theft of money from the poor so that the rich can live lavishly. We also hear plenty. We hear plenty about false piety, the religious demonstrations of the powerful, even as they exploit, oppress, and pilfer. So I ask you, isn't that something? Isn't that something? I know some of you out there, some of you love the Bible. Some of you wish I would talk a whole lot less about the Bible. There are some of you. And I know some of you are kind of in between, are working out your feelings. But wherever you are, I think we can agree that it's a pretty radical notion that the folks who assembled the Bible put in more prophetic texts than any other kind of text, disproportionately including these righteous and damning words about the societies in which they lived. In fact, some of the kings and rulers and priests named by the prophets are named nowhere else in the Bible. They are only remembered in history for their hypocrisy and their greed. Nothing is left of them, nothing is remembered of them, except for what the prophets say about them. Isn't that something? Moving on to the New Testament, this is the Christmas season, and many traditions will begin the Christmas story by talking about John the Baptist. And so when John the Baptist arrives and he is imagined wearing a shirt woven of camel hair and of living in the desert eating locusts and wild honey, our senses go off. Oh, that's a prophet. Ah, living the point. Ah, that's a prophet. I remember while I was at Divinity School at Harvard, I took preaching. One of the people I took preaching from was the great, the amazing Dr. Robert Franklin. Dr. Franklin currently serves as the professor of moral leadership at the Candler School of Theology at Emory. He previously served as the president of Morehouse University. And that's who I took preaching from, and I don't think there's ever been anybody who I've been more intimidated to preach a sermon in front of. So one day Dr. Franklin was giving a lecture, and he was telling us about a great sermon, exhorting us to preach in this way. And he talked about a sermon preached way back in 1968, April of 1968, preached at the memorial service for Martin Luther King. And so he was talking about this sermon and giving it as an example of great preaching. And Dr. Franklin, I'm going to try to do my best Dr. Franklin imitation. It's not going to be very good, but... So Dr. Franklin recalls that the preacher speaking at the memorial service for Dr. King stood up and began his remark this way. In the reign of Herod, king of Judea. And he says it a second time. In the reign of Herod, king of Judea. Now it's April. It's the memorial service for Martin Luther King, and he's reading from Luke's account of the birth of Jesus. The preacher continues a third time, in the reign of Herod, king of Judea, when Augustus was emperor and Quirinius was governor of Syria. A fourth time, in the reign of Herod, king of Judea, when Augustus was emperor and Quirinius was governor of Syria. In the reign of King Herod, when Augustus was emperor and Quirinius was governor of Caesar of Syria, Jesus was born in Bethlehem. In the reign of Governor Wallace, when Bill Connor was police chief in Birmingham, he starts listing names. When Strom Thurmond was senator of South Carolina and the Klan was rioting in Tennessee, the Lord sent us Martin Luther King. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. Robert Franklin then said, when you tell an ancient story, you're always telling a contemporary story. If you're not doing that, then what the hell are you doing? There's something else I want to say about the prophetic tradition. As great as those words sound, the other thing I want to say about the prophetic tradition is that people don't listen to prophets. Prophets are, throughout all of history, scorned, mocked, criticized, sometimes even killed. This was true of the prophets of old, and it's true of the prophets of modernity. Isaiah was not received well during his life, neither was Jeremiah. Martin Luther King was not only threatened, stabbed, attacked, and murdered, but was also widely dismissed. In 1961, 60% of Americans reported that they disapproved of the actions of the Freedom Riders. In 1963, 60% of Americans disapproved of the plans for there to be a march on Washington. And in 1966, 85% of whites polled said that demonstrations and marches by African Americans were hurting the cause of civil rights. 85%. The same thing is said today about the Black Lives Matter movement, isn't it? Of which more than half of Americans disapprove. The same thing is said about the NFL players who take a knee for the national anthem, which has similar disapproval ratings. Jesus is within that prophetic tradition. There is a time in Jesus' ministry where he goes to preach in Galilee. This is the line that is actually the title of my sermon this morning. Jesus goes to preach in his hometown. And he shows up in his hometown and he is preaching in the streets. And how do the people respond to Jesus there? He's heckled. He's abused. The crowd turns on him, booing him, calling him out, "Aren't you the son of the carpenter?" And Jesus shakes his head and mutters, "Prophets are not without honor, except in their own country and in their own house." Prophets are not without honor, except in their own country and in their own house. These words about prophets are true, aren't they? Isaiah and Jeremiah were not honored in their lifetimes. John the Baptist and Jesus certainly weren't. Martin Luther King wasn't. Or think today. Think of those people today who we hear speaking a hard truth. Speaking a hard truth. Who are silenced. Who are told not to speak. Think of so many women who speak a hard truth, who are silenced, so many people of color. You know who these prophets without honor are in our day, right? We often think of the prophets without honor in our day. Who are the prophets of our time who we fail to heed? Who do we dismiss? I have a favorite story of a prophet without honor. Think back, it's my last year of divinity school. I did my student ministry under a very accomplished minister who was serving his first year in a small church outside of Boston. So it's the middle of December 2002. And if you remember, that was just as the buildup to the Iraq War was growing increasingly feverish. And I get a call from my boss. "Hey, Tom," he says. "So I've just been asked to be a part of a delegation that the National Council of Churches is sending to Baghdad. The delegation is being led by a former senator, and we're going to observe the humanitarian conditions in Iraq, and we're going to be asked to report on the devastation that that war would have on civilians. We leave right after Christmas, unless, of course, the war started by then. Can you hold down the fort for 2 weeks while I go? So there I was, and it's a sleepy time right after Christmas. They preached 2 Sundays in a row, and you know, did a few visits, attended a few meetings, and to my surprise, I overheard some grumbling. He's been here only a few months, and now he's flying off all over the world. Why is he off getting involved in this political stuff? I bet we're going to have to hear about this during the sermons on Sunday. Truly, a prophet is not without honor, except in their own country and in their own house. The responsive reading this morning came from James Luther Adams, the most influential Unitarian theologian of the 20th century. And one strain of Adams' thought dealt with the prophetic role of the liberal church and what he termed the prophethood of all believers. He took that phrase in Protestantism, the priesthood of all believers, which says that anyone can kind of read the Bible for themselves and find their own truth. That's the priesthood of all believers in Protestantism. He said the prophethood of all believers, that all can be involved in the speaking of truth and the working for justice in the world. Adams wrote, "We see the prophet as one who stands at the edge of a community's experience and tradition, viewing human life from a piercing perspective and bringing an imperative sense of the perennial and inescapable struggle of good against evil, of justice against injustice. In the name of the Holy One, the prophet shakes us out of our pride and calls for a change of heart and mind and action. With fear and trembling, the prophet announces crisis and demands ethical decision here and now." Another strain of Adam's thought deals with church community, what he called voluntary association. He wrote extensively about covenant and about the hallmarks of the free church. He wrote about the singular importance of the free pulpit, the idea that the preacher being free to speak their conscience, their own truth, untrammeled, without fear or favor, actually is what preserves the spiritual freedom of the church. Adams tells a story that when he was a professor at the University of Chicago, he served on the board of a Unitarian church in Chicago, a Unitarian church that was segregated until the 1940s, and he served on the board as the minister there in this church, was leading the desegregation of that church. And Adams wrote how, as a board member, he worked to get the people behind it, but that one of his colleagues on the board didn't agree and kept complaining. Why is the preacher talking about that? Why is our minister doing this? Why is our minister getting political? Until Adams confronts him in a board meeting and says to him, "What is the purpose? What is the purpose of what our minister's doing? What is the purpose of this church?" "Well, I don't know." He asks a third time, a fourth time, a fifth time, a sixth time, what is the purpose of this? And finally, that member of the board says to his colleague on the board, James Luther Adams, says to him, "Well, I guess he's doing this because I need to hear it." Why is it that we so often scorn and mock and persecute and belittle and dismiss the prophets of our day, even as we with the same breath praise and revere the prophets of old? The famous poet Emily Dickinson once said, "Tell the truth, but tell it slant." I think sometimes we spend a lot of time trying to figure out a way to slant truth in a way that won't ruffle feathers, that will be perfectly heard and gladly received. But the prophetic tradition shows us the folly of this. The Hebrew prophets chose the path of being as offensive as they could, and they were discounted. But Jesus was also discounted in the same way, despite his ministry of healing. And King was discounted despite his nonviolent path. And Colin Kaepernick is discounted despite his nonviolent taking of a knee. The prophets teach that it is folly to imagine that a hard truth and a needed truth can be spoken in a way that will not be met with opposition. But the important thing is to speak the truth anyway. To speak the truth anyway, and to always, always speak the truth anyway. I leave you this morning with some words of truth from the prophets. First, Isaiah. Woe to those who make unjust laws, to those who issue oppressive decrees to deprive the poor of their rights and withhold justice from the oppressed of my people, making widows their prey and robbing the fatherless. And Zechariah, the Lord Almighty said, administer true justice, show mercy and compassion to one another. Do not oppress the widow or the fatherless, the foreigner or the poor. But then Zechariah continues, but they refused. They refused to pay attention. Stubbornly, they turned their backs on my words and covered their ears. And then Zechariah says one more word, and I continue to speak. Amen. Blessed be. And I invite us to sing a song that I don't think we've ever sung here this morning, but the tune may be familiar. It is hymn number 276, I found this one, and the words are just too good to not sing this morning. And so I invite us to hear hymn number 276, O Young and Fearless Prophet.